Good morning, everybody. Could I just ask you to take your seats? And Richard, maybe if we could just have the doors closed, that'd be great. Okay, good morning, everybody. In a moment, I'll hand over to our chair for this morning's session. But before I do that, just to dispose of three housekeeping matters. The first one, could I ask all of you just to silence your mobile phones or mobile devices? I'd be very grateful. The second is just, if you could just note the nearest fire exit to you. We have fire exits behind. We have fire exits on my right-hand side, your left. And we have one here in the corner on my left-hand side, your right-hand side. And the final piece of housekeeping is, if you do wish to tweet this morning, could you use hashtag energy policy paper, please? Okay, I'd now like if you could give a warm welcome to our chair for this morning, Miss Bernie Gray.
Thank you, Ken. Minister, ladies and gentlemen, there's a feeling of an exam hall about this. I suppose our thoughts and prayers are with everybody else who's sitting their exams this morning. But when Ken said close the doors, I can imagine how that felt for the students this morning. Anyway, we've got a more pleasant engagement this morning, and I'd like to thank you for attending, and I'm pleased to be here to chair the proceedings. This morning represents a significant opportunity for key stakeholders to air and discuss their views on a critical policy area, which has far-reaching consequences for Ireland, both nationally and internationally. In the last 10 years, Ireland has made significant strides to progress its capacity to utilise all sources of energy as optimally as possible. The challenge for us now is to sustain and indeed enhance that progress as we look forward over the next 20 to 30 years. We have a responsibility to ourselves, but also to other generations, including those taking their exams this morning, to take brave but appropriate decisions now, which will ultimately yield significant benefits for all, both economically, socially, and environmentally. This morning's seminar follows on from the extensive consultation process undertaken on the Green Paper on Energy Policy since it was published in May 2014. This process included a written consultation process whereby over 1,200 submissions were received from members of the public, and there were a number of seminars held, including on the six priority areas identified, and these included empowering energy citizens, markets, regulation and prices, planning and implementing essential energy infrastructure, ensuring a balanced and secure energy mix, putting the energy system on a sustainable pathway, and finally, driving economic opportunity. In order to explore these issues further, Minister White will provide an update on the emerging policy options prior to publication of the Energy Policy Statement later this year in October. This will be followed by an extensive question and answer session where you will get the opportunity to make any comments you may have or indeed to raise any questions you have with the Minister and Ken Spratt, Assistant Secretary. Minister, I now invite you to make your address. Thank you.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and to all of our distinguished guests, and welcome to Dublin Castle. I want to thank Bernie Gray for chairing today's proceedings, and I want to thank, at the outset, everyone who participated in the consultation process to which Bernie referred that has informed our thinking about the forthcoming energy white paper. The purpose of today's event is to set out how our approach has developed and to hear your responses and insights into into the white paper process prior to the conclusion and publication of that definitive policy statement later this year. Last December, I attended, on behalf of the Irish government, the Lima Conference of the Parties in advance of the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change, which, as you know, is due to take place in Paris later this year. Indeed, 2015 is a most important year for international engagement and, we hope, decisions on sustainable development and climate change. This is because there are, in fact, three critical discussions taking place at UN level this year. And I think it is worth noting that Ireland is the co-chair of one of these processes, the one concerned with the new Sustainable Development Goals. In Lima, I was struck by the testimonies of the South Pacific Island communities, where severe coastal erosion caused by global warming has already forced coastal communities to relocate further and further inland. Their leaders told me and others that in a short time, the islands would have to be abandoned altogether, along with homes, communities, languages, and cultures that have survived and thrived for centuries. Undeniable evidence of the impact of climate change is emerging here in Ireland too, in the form of extreme weather events, rising sea levels, and changes to ecosystems. In 2014, Storm Darwin wreaked havoc, causing widespread damage to infrastructure and the landscape, as it left over 280,000 homes without electricity. The impact of global warming demands that we put sustainability at the very centre of our energy policy. The scale of the challenge was starkly outlined in the report of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, which informed the Lima conference. It is now absolutely clear that the world must replace gas and coal with renewable energy sources within 35 years. Our vision here must be equally clear and equally ambitious. We must and we will transform Ireland's energy production and consumption patterns so that by 2050, our system will be largely decarbonised. This vision comes with a pledge to all of our citizens, our communities, industry, and those who work to provide energy to our homes and workplaces, that policy will ensure certainty, stability, and affordability as we make the transition to a low-carbon future. Energy security is one of the key pillars of energy policy, and it is an important dimension of the EU Energy Union. It is also an important priority for Ireland, given our high dependence on imported energy sources, mainly oil and gas. There is no single action that by itself can achieve energy security. We will rely on a range of measures to ensure that the light continues to come on when we flick the switch. Many of the initiatives required in order to reach our carbon emission targets, such as increasing energy efficiency and diversifying energy sources, also contribute to our energy security. We fully support EU-level initiatives, like fostering regional cooperation, which complement our already close cooperation with the United Kingdom, for example, and other jurisdictions. A range of oil, gas, and electricity infrastructure projects could enhance our energy security. In some cases, with EU support as Projects of Common Interest, or PCIs. Such projects can help address interconnection, enhance security of supply, market integration, and sustainability. I understand that an application is imminent to onboard Planola for planning permission for the North-South Transmission Line project. I am fully persuaded that this project is of critical importance to the effective functioning of the electricity market throughout the island, to security of supply in Northern Ireland, and to support the deployment of renewable energy. The transition to a system based on clean technologies, some of which have yet to be invented, will be a process, not an event. Our extensive consultation over the last year has taught us that this transition can only be successful if it has the support, the active support of all its stakeholders. This gives us the added responsibility to include and involve all our citizens and our communities in a transformation which will involve profound changes in the way we generate, transmit, store, conserve, and use our energy. We will, of course, face constraints. These will include the rate of technology developments and the availability of capital and other resources. Some of our decisions will involve costs as well as benefits. We will be presented with many difficult choices as we juggle the sometimes conflicting priorities of affordability, sustainability, and energy security. We must be informed by the opportunities and responsibilities that come with an interconnected European and global economy and polity. Above all, our transition will depend on human goodwill and ingenuity. The White Paper will outline in detail how we intend to make the transition. It will build on all of the work undertaken since the publication of the 2007 White Paper, work which includes a range of policies and initiatives, including the establishment of the single electricity market, the development of renewable electricity and its integration into our grid, and the rollout of a series of energy efficiency programmes. This geographically peripheral nation will continue to rely on imported fossil fuels during the energy transition, albeit that this dependence will diminish over time. This means that improved interconnectivity with other member states, an integral element of the recently initiated European Energy Union, must be a high priority. So we will continue to work to unlock EU funding for interconnectivity projects, like the recently approved project to twin a 50-kilometre section of the gas transmission pipe between Ireland and Scotland. We are also cooperating with our partners in the North Sea's country's offshore grid initiative, and we are continuing to work on the Irish-Scottish links on energy study. The integrated single electricity market project, currently being undertaken by the independent regulators, is also essential. The White Paper will guide and inform our collective approach and actions, particularly in the period to 2030, which is an important staging post on the journey to the decarbonised economy and society of 2050. We stand at a climate crossroads, but we are not alone. Every other nation shares the challenge. As Mary Robinson has commented, I quote, "The generations that came before us didn't know that their actions were causing climate change. The generations who come after us risk inheriting an unsolvable problem. We are the generation that can make the difference," unquote. Our actions will be guided and supported by the frameworks and commitments agreed on the international stage. In December, the United Nations Paris Conference, that's the conference of the parties to the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change, must reach agreement on post-2020 targets to limit emissions and ensure that average global temperatures do not increase by more than 2 degrees centigrade. Everyone present here will know that 16% of our energy must come from renewables by 2020. We are making good progress. Currently, around 8% of our energy comes from renewables, so we are, as it were, halfway there. Within that binding 16% target, we must generate 40% of our electricity consumption through renewables, along with 12% in the heat sector and 10% in transport. However, the second half of the journey will be very challenging, and we will need to redouble our efforts as we continue along this path. At the October 2014 European Council, the heads of state and government agreement on headline targets reached agreement on headline targets for 2030. Overall, Europe committed to reducing its greenhouse gas emissions by 40%, to increasing to 27% the proportion of energy derived from renewables, and to increasing Europe's energy efficiency by 27%. Government departments, including my own, are currently working together to ensure that specific targets for Ireland are technically feasible, cost-effective, and fair in terms of burden sharing across all EU member states. Eliminating waste and the aggressive targeting of improved energy efficiency will be key to our transition to a sustainable energy future. This is one of the few elements of energy policy that is essentially completely within our national control. Indeed, technological developments like smart meters and mobile phone-controlled heating systems will increasingly allow citizens themselves, ourselves, to boost energy efficiency and save money through better management of energy consumption. Enhanced energy efficiency delivers real and measurable benefits to the entire economy. It has the potential to boost employment and improve living standards by sustaining jobs based in the communities where efficiency upgrades are delivered. It can enrich the lives of our citizens by improving their health and allowing them to live in comfort at home for longer, thereby reducing the costs of health, housing, and social services. It can do this while cutting emissions and improving energy security by reducing our fossil fuel imports. Becoming more energy efficient means changing our behavior and our habits. Our children have a lot to teach us in this regard. More than 3/4 of our schools have achieved at least one Antashke green flag, and the Green Schools Programme has helped divert 4,700 tonnes of waste from landfill. Over 15 million units of electricity have been saved through reduced energy consumption in schools. The total average, or total savings rather, on waste, energy, water and transport will exceed €8 million in 2014 alone. Meanwhile, the National Energy Efficiency Action Plan has led to €700 million in savings from reduced fossil fuel imports. But we need to do more. We need to increase the funding available under the Better Energy Programme. And we need to complement grants with financing schemes to encourage more householder participation. I want to see substantially reduced barriers to the installation of energy efficiency systems in homes, in businesses, and in public service. Onshore wind has so far been at the centre of Ireland's renewable energy generation. It has served us well, and it will continue to do so. But the next period of energy transition will also see the development of new commercial and late-stage solutions which are likely to change the mix of renewables as technologies like solar PV, offshore wind, and carbon capture and storage mature and become more cost-effective. My department is actively engaged in the development and support of renewable energy. The White Paper will outline and embrace a number of initiatives that will provide investor certainty and contribute to the achievement of our renewable electricity targets. In the electricity sector, we will publish a study of the costs and savings that will flow from additional renewable redeployment or deployment in 2020. The Offshore Renewable Energy Development Plan will provide a framework for the sustainable development of Ireland's offshore renewable energy resources, identifying the opportunity for increasing Indigenous production of renewable electricity. This will contribute to reductions in our greenhouse gas emissions, will improve the security of our energy supply, and will create jobs in the green economy. We'll embark on a consultation about future renewable supports, looking at quantum, technologies, and mechanisms. In the transport sector, the purchase of electric vehicles will continue to be incentivized through grant schemes. We are working with the Department of Transport, Tourism and Sport on railway efficiency and measures to green buses and taxis. Work is continuing on an Exchequer-funded renewable heat incentive, which will be launched in 2016. Our draft bioenergy action plan, which was published just last October, will inform policy developments in this area, with particular emphasis on heat and transport. Our energy transition will continue to depend on harnessing technological change, which will also bring wider benefits to our economy. My department, together with the Department of Jobs, Enterprise and Innovation, has been developing the European Energy Innovation Hub with cross-government actions to develop technologies and capture their enterprise and employment potential. As with many of the other challenges faced by mankind in the past, technological change has played and is playing a vital role. I fully expect that technologies that have yet to be invented will also play a role in our transition, and we must wisely balance the choice between acting and waiting. The Energy Policy White Paper will provide new investors and existing market participants with the certainty and confidence that they need. This will enable them to continue to innovate in the technologies that will diminish our carbon footprint, reduce costs, improve energy security, and promote national and regional economic development. All the evidence tells us that new energy infrastructure is and will continue to be vital to the transition to a carbon-free future. Yet opposition to some of this infrastructure in local communities is a fact of life in the public discourse on energy and energy policy. We will continue to assess the need for new infrastructure and facility upgrades with robust, evidence-informed analysis. But I have heard the demand that citizens be involved in the decisions that affect them. And I think we have learned from the often insensitive approach to community concerns that we have seen in the past. The recent ErGrid publication, Your Grid, Your Views, Your Tomorrow, is a welcome sign of change in this regard, and one that can inform others in the sector. The White Paper will declare that the day of unilateral, as it were, top-down energy policy is over. It will set out a new direction in which we will better listen to citizens, respect their concerns, and give them an ongoing opportunity to input into policy development and implementation, where the onus will be on the state and the industry to demonstrate the need for new projects and to clearly explain complex technical issues and to show that we have rigorously studied all the potential alternatives, where we reduce the barriers to viable small-scale renewable energy projects contributing to the grid, and where the communities that host energy infrastructure have a genuine stake and receive commensurate benefits. Our energy transition will respect our people as concerned energy citizens, determined to combat global warming and its impact on their planet, their communities, and their children. It will also have a robust focus on the cost to consumers of the transition to a fully decarbonized energy system. It will respect our citizens' expectations of affordable bills and their desire to control their own energy consumption. As part of the preparation for the White Paper, I launched a public consultation on affordable energy in February of this year. I will publish our affordable energy strategy later on this year. Issues relating to the regulatory framework and the mandate of the regulator were raised in many of the submissions to this consultation process. And given the passage of time since the regulatory framework was established, it is clear to me that reviews of both are required. Ireland's independent energy regulation continues to perform its essential role in a well-functioning energy market, providing the stability and the certainty necessary for continued energy investment. Regulatory accountability is another important issue we have to address in the White Paper. Consumers have to grapple with electricity and gas retail competition to get the best price, get the best product and best service offer for their needs. So the issue of prices, costs, affordability and competitiveness was understandably raised by many contributors during the consultation process for this White Paper. Many acknowledged that we have structural issues related to our scale and peripherality, and that we are a price taker on international markets. These factors put the market we have established into sharp focus. I am, however, troubled by plain contradictions in perspectives on the functioning of markets. On the one hand, industry asserts that the market is functioning properly, citing, for example, switching rates by domestic customers. The regulator stated to the Oireachtas Committee that the retail market is working in Ireland, again referencing switching rates as evidence. On the other hand, consumers and householders expressed their disappointment and frustration at the prices they are asked to pay and the delay in passing on wholesale price reductions. This discourse, if we can characterise it even as a discourse, is at a volume that cannot, I think, be explained away by the natural tensions that exist between buyers and sellers. There needs to be greater trust and confidence between consumers and the industry. As I have indicated to them, I very much welcome efforts by the industry and its trade association in reinforcing this essential trust. The White Paper will be a critical instrument of navigation towards the energy transition that we must make in this country. All of us, every individual, every household, every government department, every corporation and organisation has a responsibility and a part to play in this transition. All of us want to safeguard our environment for future generations. That means that we must expedite the transition to a low carbon future. For our own sake and for the sake of our children and grandchildren and those starting their exams today, as was mentioned by our chair earlier on. For the people and communities in Ireland affected by the 2014 storms, as well as communities in the South Pacific and other countries that are so vulnerable to climate change. For the planet itself. Because of this, ladies and gentlemen, I think the most important aspect of the White Paper will be to recognise the role we have as citizens and to enable each and every one of us to play our part in the energy transition, which is one of the greatest projects of our age. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Minister. So as you've heard, we have an ambitious vision of energy transition to a low carbon future. But based on the pillars of energy security, affordability, and competitiveness, but most of all sustainability, and one which is underpinned by extensive consultation and ongoing engagement with all citizens and stakeholders. At this point, I'd like to open up the floor for any questions or comments. If you have a question, I'd ask you to put up your hand, state your name and your organisation. Thank you.
Hello. Excuse me. Hello, my name is Sheila O'Brien. I'm a member of Kildare Environmental Awareness Group. I'm a citizen who lives in rural Ireland. I'm a landowner and I'm a farmer. So I understand all very well about climate, about land management, etc. Now, I welcome the idea that there can be citizen and stakeholder information session today. However, as an individual who lives in rural Ireland, today with the people here, I feel I'm very much in an urban environment. And the Minister has stated that everybody has to partake in the future energy policy of this country. However, as a member of rural Ireland, I feel that the people of rural Ireland, and in particular the people of the Midlands, currently at this moment in time, are being asked to take a burden that is unbearable. And when we talked about engaging with stakeholders, et cetera, and people who would host, in particular I'm referring to the wind energy, and I'm referring to the fact of lack of guidelines, where the current application in Abor Pinola for the Machna wind farm have wind industrial turbines of 169 metres in height placed 500 to 1300 metres in people's homes. And I also, as a person who experienced engagement with developers, I have to say that the way the developers engage with local communities, I would not say would inspire confidence in any correct or proper engagement, and I would have proof of that. Now, furthermore, I've just one final comment to ask the Minister, because I feel people in Ireland, in rural Ireland, are not really properly engaged with. You have your conferences here and you've representatives from different organisations, businesses, etc., NGOs, etc., but the individuals on the ground, many of whom I meet, are absolutely flabbergasted and bombarded with policy documents, many of them who may have not have had the huge opportunity for good education that many other people have had. So I really think the whole focus on re-engagement has to be changed on meeting people on a one-to-one basis and correct engagement, and not sidelining out individuals. As has been stated at a conference in Dunleary recently on public participation, whereby certain people were told how to engage with rural communities and single out individuals who would influence people who may be quite vulnerable, in fact. And again, I have evidence of that. And my final point here is that recently the Minister in the Dáil, you gave figures concerning CO2, which was displaced, the fossil fuel tonnage displaced by wind energy. Now, a TD asked the question, how much hydro is displaced by wind energy? And his question was not allowed into the Dáil. I have the letter here turning his question down. So I'd just like to ask the Minister himself today, how much hydro, which is a renewable energy, is displaced by wind? Thank you.
Okay, sorry, could just at this point, one of the key themes that has come through your comments, I think, is the issue of community engagement and models of engagement. And I think the purpose of this session is to hear comments, but equally to hear from some guest speakers we have with us who are experts in this field. And just in the row behind you, we're very pleased to have with us today Professor Patrick Devine Wright. And he would be, hopefully, make a contribution to us to outline some of the research that he has done in terms of community engagement.
Right. I was going to ask a question, actually, but I'm not sure that's what you want me to do. But well, I'm very pleased to be here, and it's coincidental because I've been speaking to people in Airgrid today about community engagement, wider issues. So there's some interesting discussions taking place, which I'm very pleased to be part of. I think the specific question I had to the Minister was about the concept which in the UK has become known as shared ownership. And in Denmark, for example, they have passed legislation which obliges renewable energy developers to share 20% of the equity in onshore wind energy projects, for example, with citizens, stakeholders, local people. And this is distinct from community benefit provision, which is where developers annually, perhaps, place money into funds which local people then can get access to and use. And the point I would make about shared ownership is that it is different from receiving a sum of money from a benefactor. it engages people in a different way psychologically, I think, because they themselves become part of the project rather than outsiders or people who are recipients in a top-down manner. And I've heard directly from people about how they can point to a turbine or point to something and say, that's ours. And they have a different relationship to it. They name it, they paint it, or whatever. And it means something different to them. Now, given that the UK has, since 2014, been looking very strongly into shared ownership and have set up a task force and presumed that any renewable energy project with a greater value of £2.5 million will have shared ownership involved in it, what are the plans for Ireland, if any, around this same issue?
Ken?
Yep. Thank you very much, Chair. Maybe just to take them in order, Sheila, thanks very much for your contribution. We would have met previously in New Ross, and I know you had a question for me at New Ross, which took me some time to find the answer to, but I you got the reply, that's great. One of the things that has been an eye-opener for us during the consultation process is how much we actually learned as we went around and had our stakeholder engagement sessions. We did have 7 in Dublin, I absolutely admit that, but we did have 4 regional seminars. We had one in Moat, we had one in Sligo, we had one in Cork, and we had one in New Ross. And the key purpose of that for us was to ensure that we identified all of the issues that we needed to identify in the development of the policy paper, but more importantly, to ensure that we tested the assumptions upon which we were making our policy or putting our policy suggestions to Minister White. And I can assure you that having had those stakeholder engagement sessions in regional rural Ireland, we did learn an awful lot from that. Having said that, we can always improve things. I think we have improved things in terms of the development of this piece of policy by comparison to 2007, when we would have had fairly limited engagement. But there is always room for improvement. On your question regarding how much hydro was displaced by wind, we did draft that reply for Minister. We understood the question was being was around priority dispatch, and this is where the Commission for Energy Regulation have priority dispatch rules, and we answered them on that basis. But to answer your specific question, I will have to come back to you, I'm afraid, offline.
And just a comment offering a non-carbon energy being displaced by another. Non-renewable energy, which is not CO2 based.
My point being, a non-CO2 based energy, renewable energy, hydro, is being displaced by wind. It's not displacing fossil, and the whole issue is climate change and fossil displacement. So why do we have wind displacing another renewable energy? That's the point. Yeah. And constraint payments made.
Yeah.
That if I was a businessman, it doesn't work.
Well,
you know, it just seems that people are being codded on that. And just one point on community engagement, it is not sufficient. It is definitely not. I live in rural Ireland, I know.
Well, all I can say to you on that is we are trying our best to improve the way that we do engage, and I would hope that we have made some improvement. I do accept that we can always improve things further. In terms of the displacement of hydro by wind or vice versa, there are complicated rules about which source of wind gets dispatched onto the system first, and that's something that we can take a closer look at. In terms of Professor Divine Wright's contribution regarding the UK task force and part ownership and how that does change the psychological engagement, that's something that we've been monitoring closely. It's something that is of interest to us. We do have our renewable energy planning and development framework, the scoping report about to be published, and there is a piece in that around the part of co-ownership. So it's something we're looking at with interest, something we can learn from the UK on, and something which we would like to analyse further and come to a position on. I don't know whether, Brian, you want to say anything further on that. Just to take the mic. Just to mention, we do have our experts in the front row here, our heads of function, with responsibility for each of the priorities. So just Brian leads our renewable energy division.
You know, just to add really to what Ken said, that when the Renewable Electricity Policy and Development Framework scoping document is published, there's a specific piece that seeks to consult on that and get views of both citizens and stakeholders and as to appropriate models to deploy in Ireland. And once that consultation happens, we will be bringing forward proposals to the Minister.
And maybe if I could just add, Chair, just to that, one of the things, again, which we learned as we went around was the different types of citizen when it comes to ownership. So you potentially could have citizens who potentially could be positively engaged in a part ownership way. There are citizens who want to form their own wholly owned projects, and we've seen quite a few of those, and it's wonderful to see that sort of local leadership. So that's part of what we'll be trying to figure out as well. And then there's also the citizen, as Sheila mentioned, where you're not a part owner, and you find yourself coming up against these big project developers, which government and minister himself will say we've been quite disappointed with a lot of what has gone on in the past, particularly in the Midlands, and that's something that we do need to consider and address as well.
Okay, we'll take three questions together and then we can respond to three, because there are quite a number of questions coming forward.
Will I go?
Just over here.
How you doing? Ray Conroy. I'm with the Laois Community Group.
Could you state your organisation?
It's Laois Wind Energy Awareness Group. It's just what we go under, but we're a small community group. Obviously, we're in the same situation as Sheila and a lot more people here. Just a question for Minister White with regard to his presentation. He said, on fair play, he's going to look at solar PV offshore and carbon capture and all that as, new technologies that haven't been invented yet. But did I hear him right in saying that basically there's a cost-benefit analysis that will show benefit by 2020 in order to guarantee investor certainty? I mean, is he guaranteeing that there is going to be a benefit from a cost-benefit without actually doing it? And does it actually mean that there has been no cost-benefit to date in the policy that's in? Are we waiting for a cost-benefit analysis? Does that make sense?
Yes.
There's also just one other thing. He also mentioned regional cooperation in regards to PCIs and EU targets. But it's my understanding that all targets, as it stand, are national targets. So how are you having regional cooperation? Any targets are national targets until 2020. So you're talking about regional cooperation, but how can you incorporate our targets with UK targets or French targets, or whatever?
Okay.
Lisa Ryan, UCD. I'd like to thank the opportunity for a preview of the white paper. It's great. And I also welcome the prioritisation of energy efficiency and renewables in the forthcoming white paper. I think it's very exciting, the scale of the transformation that's evident in the next, I think, very few years. I think what's very interesting is to see the convergence of both the energy demand and energy supply side sectors. And I suppose I would like to encourage, this is a comment really, to encourage policymakers working in energy efficiency and renewables to really work on this in an integrated manner, and hopefully that the policy that can be developed would reflect an integrated energy system so that we don't have renewables policy being developed in separation from energy efficiency policy. So that's my comment. And then I have a question on energy efficiency. Given the scale of the targets that we're looking at and the level of, retrofit that we need in the building sector, for example, there's been a lot of talk about switching from grants to finance. And why might we be thinking about maybe regulation in addition? Because there's so many barriers, I think, in the building sector. Might we think of regulation, for example, in the rental sector? Or would that kind of thing maybe be in the white paper in the future? Thank you.
Okay. We've plenty of time, so please don't despair if we don't come to you immediately.
Yes, good morning. Malcolm Brown from BW Energy. Thank you for your presentation, Minister, and thank you for the opportunity to engage here today. Ireland's unusual in that she has a single coal-fired power station at Money Point, which is due to come off its natural life in 2025. And it's unusual because that's controlled by a semi-state, so that's under the influence of the government. And it's very unusual in the sense that it supplies up to a quarter of the entire power supply of Ireland. So with the burning of cheap American coal at Money Point, you are effectively undermining the decarbonisation through the support mechanisms for renewables. And since 2007, when the original policy was put in place for all wind, there have been substantial developments in large-scale renewable power generation from sustainable biomass in Germany, the United Kingdom, and Denmark. Could you comment, please, on what your thoughts are on the strategic importance of Money Point to the decarbonisation of Ireland and the way in which it's currently undermining the decarbonisation of the power sector?
Okay, we've had three questions. I'm going to invite responses to those before we invite any more questions. So, in the first instance, Ray raised the point in terms of cost-benefit analysis underpinning investment in solar.
Yeah, sure. What was mentioned in the Minister's speech, Ray, was four organisations, ourselves, the Commission for Energy Regulation, the Sustainable Energy Authority of Ireland, and Airgrid, got together and looked at the investment that has been made in wind thus far, and looked at a scenario in 2020. And we have found, and the report will be published shortly, and Brian may wish to add to this, it has found that that wind does wash its face, if you like, that the wind, in terms of its reduction in wholesale electricity prices, does cover, that wholesale reduction does cover off on the subsidies that are made in order to make that happen. If I can finish, and I'm just conscious that you don't have a microphone, so other people can't hear you, but if I can just finish. So we're happy that the analysis, the quadrilateral study of the four organisations, does show that the investment in wind is cost effective. Your question around the targets, which I didn't quite understand, but just to mention targets on PCIs, in the Energy Union package of documentation that was published by the European Commission recently, there was a paper on interconnection, and in the interconnection document, there was references to targets for further interconnection, and it did highlight a few countries which needed to improve its interconnection, and Ireland was one of those. So I think that might be the issue around targets and interconnection and PCIs, but I'm not entirely sure, and I'm happy to talk to you offline if not. Just in relation to Lisa's comments, well, obviously this morning we're delighted to be able to give a preview, and it is the case that energy efficiency will be prioritised, and that's something that the Department and Minister is very committed to. We are looking in terms of the integration of energy efficiency and renewable energy. We do have very close working of the heads of function within the department, but we also have the SEAI under the leadership of Dr. Brian Motherway, very conscious of the need to ensure that there is good collaboration between energy efficiency initiatives and renewable energy, and long may that continue. Yes, it is the case that we have been predominantly grants-based. We've spent quite a bit of time trying to figure out, can we introduce a pay-as-you-save value proposition? It hasn't been successfully achieved in any country around the world. In the countries that have tried it, it hasn't been a great success, but we're continuing to work on some analysis and pilots and trialing to see if we can come up with a value proposition whereby we can combine grants and financing, and more to come on that. Brian, I might ask you just to take the question on Money Point and biomass, which was, or the comments which were put by Malcolm Brown from BW Energy.
I might just, before doing that, Ken, just add a little bit on the costs and benefits of electricity. Just to confirm, there have been a series of reports done since we established our targets for 2020, and we very much have gone for the least cost options, and certainly when you put all the costs and benefits together, there is a net benefit to society from the approach we're taking, and I think there's ample evidence to show that. Just in terms of Money Point, obviously decisions around Money Point and its future are a matter for the company concerned. In terms of what happens, you know, we are obviously going to be looking at the energy mix going forward. I think one of the key things is we have a target for renewable electricity for 2020, which is 40%, and we're working to achieve that. as the Minister said, we'll be looking to make an ambitious contribution that's technically feasible, cost-effective and fair out to 2030. And in the context of those decisions, clearly we'll be looking at the overall mix, fuel mix in the electricity sector. In addition, we'll shortly be consulting on supports to succeed REFIT. And again, that'll be very much an open consultation where people can make their views known. And we'll be looking to see what are the most cost-effective ways for Ireland to continue progressing the decarbonisation of our electricity system.
Okay. Can we take three more questions? And we'll take them from different parts of the room, so we're quite random. So over here first.
Brian Britton, National Offshore Wind Association of Ireland. Minister, thank you for a very ranging presentation. My question is specifically about the concern the industry might have about the 2020 targets, because with the projected RES heat and transport shortfall, with the economic recovery, the targets were set at 1.7%, where economic recovery is heading up to about 4.8%. New data center demand, such as Apple, an increasing reduction in onshore wind investment due to planning guideline concerns and increased rates issue, and kind of projects being turned down. If there is this doubt about Ireland meeting its 2020 targets, and with the excessive fines that Europe is threatening, is there a possibility that the stranded offshore wind asset could be reconsidered in the mix before 2020?
Okay, at the back.
Thank you. David Healy, Oxfam, Ireland. The government's policy, One World, One Future on international development, contains a commitment to ensure policy coherence so that all government policies support our development policy. And this is something we've been raising both in the white paper process and in relation to the bioenergy strategy. It's a bit concerning that we seem to be moving to implementation of the bioenergy strategy while it's still a draft, and I'm wondering where the strategic environmental assessment and public consultation on that is. Now, our concern is of the impact of bioenergy in particular in developing countries. We'd like to be in a position to react to an analysis from the department of this impact. We expect to see it in the SEA document. We don't know where it's going to come in relation to this white paper process because the analysis hasn't been done. I'm wondering, is it going to be part of the is it going to be looked at by an interdepartmental committee which is responsible for ensuring policy coherence for development? This isn't just a theoretical question. We've seen the impact of European biofuels legislation on developing countries in recent years, and Brian O'Gallagher and the UCC team's analysis of decarbonised Ireland in 2050 shows bioenergy as the majority source of renewables and shows imports as a majority of that bioenergy. So the question really for the Minister and the Department is, when are we going to get the analysis of the impact and how are we going to ensure that we're not undermining our development policy? Thank you.
Okay. Over here.
Yes, thank you. Thank you, Minister, for your presentation. I'm Fergal Duff from the Irish Doctors Environmental Association. I recently attended a workshop in SEI, in fact, last week, on the best practice guidance for offshore renewable energy. And basically, it seemed to me that the negative discourse that the Minister is talking about, if we take the business as usual, where on the one side you have industry, the other side the government and the stakeholders involved in projects where there's always a clash, that we haven't really taken sort of a step back and look why that is happening. And there are several things that could be changed there. First of all, there's a huge problem between the confusion of statute law and soft law. And the guidance, on the one hand, if we take soft law in terms of international conventions, if we look at, for example, the ecosystem approach, if we look at the EIAs, EISs, is all available. The problem is how it's implemented, and that really needs to be looked at. Then you have the confusion on the statute law, which is very often impenetrable. Industry doesn't, if you get an investor coming into this country, he's totally confused. He doesn't know, if he's investing in wind, he doesn't know, first of all, it's difficult to interpret the statute law, and then his guidance on the soft law is not available. And really, I think the department could make easy, simple changes to change that, to turn that around by actually outlining what exactly is required. That's one thing that I think would be very, very useful on all fronts. I'm not talking about just the investor. I'm talking about also the whole environmental aspect of the thing. The second thing, I think, is the whole EIS, EIA process is flawed, fundamentally for one reason, and that is it's commissioned by the developer. And this needs to change. It's not good for the developer, it's not good for the stakeholder, it's not good for environmentalists, it's not good for health practitioners. This could be easily changed where you have the developer pays for the EIA or EIS, but it's commissioned by the authorities. So that's one fundamental flaw, because what happens is, why it's not good for the developer is simply because his experts, whether they be ecologists, geologists, or whatever expert is required, will come up with one report. The developer often changes what they say. On the other side, the environmentalists will come up with their ecologists, and there's a clash. And I've seen this happen so often, and it's such a wasteful process, both environmentally, economically, and you just have to look at the evidence or the number of projects in Ireland that have had disastrous results. Just take one, for example, the Bottle Hill dump. You know, a huge amount of money, of taxpayers' money, sitting there, wasted because a process wasn't followed. So the guidance is there. You have the ecosystem approach, which if utilized, I think would go a long way to solve some of the problems that we're having in the country at the moment. So that's really basic.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, we've had three questions. We'll just group our responses to those.
Okay, maybe if I just take them in reverse order. Fergal, thanks very much for your contribution. And I know, again, Fergal, we've seen you at least two, I think, of the regional events, and your contributions were very valuable. I think it's an interesting suggestion around the developer paying for, but the authorities controlling the EIS, the EIA. It's something we would certainly have to consider with, along with our colleagues from the Department of the Environment, who have responsibility for planning law generally. I know, Minister, one of the proposals that we will be putting to you is an interdepartmental group which would oversee the implementation of energy policy, because we have found over the last 18 months that there is so many actors, if you like, across government required to be proactive in order to deliver good policy and implement good policy. So that's one of the issues that we could certainly raise with our colleagues at the Department of the Environment. In terms of Brian Britton's, the role, the future role for offshore, and whether or not it'll happen before 2020, we will be shortly initiating our consultation on post-refit 3. We will be trying to ensure maximum value for money when it comes to the rolling out of renewable energy, to ensure that we get maximum bang for buck, if you like, and ensure that the taxpayer, who will have to ultimately foot the bill, or the electricity bill payer, and nothing is ruled in or out. So we will see what the outcome of refit 4 consultations are in terms of the role for offshore. And again, Brian, you might want to add to that. But before I hand over to Brian, on Mr. Healy's contribution around bioenergy and the impact on developing countries, yes, it's something that, if I may say so, Minister, both you and your predecessors, particularly Minister Rabbit, were very, very focused on in the discussions at a European level. And it's something that we're very mindful of, the need to do the right thing on that. But Brian, I might just ask you to comment specifically on SEA and bioenergy strategy.
Yeah, just on the bioenergy strategy, the first thing I'd like to say, the draft plan does have an explicit commitment to fully, I suppose, implement the ILUC provisions brought forward at a European level, and is very conscious of the potential adverse impacts of bioenergy and indirect land use change. In terms of the SEA and AA, that's one of the first things that the cross-departmental group that's being set up to oversee the draft plan is going to manage the SEA and AA. We're about to appoint consultants to undertake it. We've just, RFT period has just closed, we've bids in. We'll be selecting consultants, and very shortly that work will be beginning. And all relevant departments will be involved, including the Department of Foreign Affairs. So the concerns that are expressed will certainly be reflected in that work.
Minister?
Yeah, just a couple of brief comments, if I may. First of all, just in relation to the point that our doctor colleague raised in respect of the requirements and the, I suppose, the knowledge that's available or the information that's available, for example, to investors and to others. I mean, if it's possible for us to improve that, I think we should do it. And I, you know, I'd be quite happy to talk to you or hear what you have to say separately from this formal session about how requirements or, you know, rules or otherwise can be made clearer. And I think that's something that we want to do across government always, is to ensure that what we're saying is communicated in a way that's understandable to people. Because as you rightly say, sometimes legislation is, you know, is complex and sometimes turgid. I have to say, sometimes necessarily so, because of the issues that are being addressed in legislation. But if we can actually translate some of those provisions in legislation into something that's more easily absorbed, whether by industry or by citizens, in fact, I would say especially by citizens, because industry will tend to have advices available to it, and citizens, I think, are entitled to understand what the law is and what it means. So I've no difficulty about addressing that. Can I just make a more general point, though? It's sort of 10:05, and we have some time still. We don't have a huge amount of time, but we certainly have some time. Could I just encourage? I'll just say this personally to everybody. You've heard that we've gone on a sort of a trajectory since last summer. So we had the Green Paper was published. We had an enormous number, very helpful contributions from many of whom are in this room and others, and we've absorbed them, gone through them. And we now are reaching the stage where we're not, I wouldn't quite describe it as the 11th hour, but it's certainly, you know, 9 or 10 o'clock in the process, a 12-hour process, if I may call it that. So I would actually invite people, and of course I might get a torrent now for having said this, but I would invite people to reflect on, and don't worry about being critical, by the way, to reflect on, are there aspects, are there items, preferably at a kind of a high level, that you think need to be in this white paper. They need to be in this white paper. You might maybe have heard enough about them. Please try as far as possible, and I say this with respect to everybody in the room, not direct sectoral issues, because I mean, inevitably people look at it from their own perspective, and that I understand and fully respect. But are there big thoughts here that we're missing? That's what I'd like to hear as minister, to ensure that I can absorb that in the time available, because we still have 2-3 months to do this. We'll take it to government in the summer. So let's not leave the room with one or two matters that you're burning up about, that you haven't heard anything about, and you think it should be in this government's white paper on such a critical issue for the future. And if it involves an element of criticism, I don't mind. I can take it. I just want to get this white paper right. And the second point, and I'll conclude on this to give you the time, is that be assured that all of the different reports that you hear us talking about, the bioenergy draft report, the offshore initiatives, all the various reports and consultations, the white paper will pull them together. The white paper won't be something separate from all of the other work that we're doing. I think it's important that people understand that. So it will have to, I use the word embrace in my speech, will pull in all of the strands of the different work that Brian has described in different policy areas. It won't be happening in some way removed from all the other. And that'll be a job of work to make sure that all those strands are pulled into the white paper, even in circumstances where some of that work, as you've heard, will be a work in progress. But we'll have to actually, you know, do more than just simply tick a box and say, oh yeah, that's happening over there. It will have to pull it all in. So that would just be my appeal.
Okay. There are obviously a lot of people who want to respond to that, Minister. Could I just make the point, we're not going to get through all the questions that are evidently in the audience today. So we're going to put a process in place to take a record of any questions which remain unanswered at the end of this session, and you'll receive a separate response from the Minister and the Department in relation to those questions. Okay? So again, we're going to take 3. Okay? Fourth row here. Yeah.
Yes, thank you very much, and I'll be about a minute. That's just, I'll keep it short. I know you have to get through things. I have a number of points. I'm Val Martin from the European Platform Against Wind Farms. I'm a member of Environmental Action Ireland, which deals to promote sustainable environment through the rule of law. So the first question I want to put, I have a few here, and I'll try and prioritise them. Last September in Maynooth, Minister Eamon Ryan said that nobody told him about the legal requirements for under the Aarhus Convention and the SEA Directive. It's there on the Department of Energy's website, as clear as crystal. There's no SEA done at European level, no SEA done at Irish level. This is unlawful, and you'll, if you don't know me now, you'll know me when the pylons, when the North-South Interconnector was up, because I intend to challenge it on that single issue and advocated myself. So I'm a serious player in this, and I mean, this isn't public consultation. You can't have consultation in a situation like this. But I want to ask the Minister, I've already met Pat Robert, his predecessor, I've informed him of this. I'm trying to engineer a situation where no minister can come along later and say he didn't know. What effort have you made to find out and to educate your people? Have you spoken to the Attorney General about the non-compliance? The Aarhus Compliance Committee have already scolded Ireland several times and ruled we're in breach. These are legally binding things. The SEA Directive is part of EU. This whole thing is an EU beast, and its EU law applies to it. So, I know you won't invoke it, but I'll invoke it. The second point is you're talking about cheap bills, cheap prices. 40% of the cost of an ESB bill is the electricity. 30% is the network, and the other 30% is levies. The cost of ordinary fossil fuel is on average recently at 5.7 cent. The cost of wind is 80 cent. We should have 6.5 megawatts of generating capacity. We have 9.8, we're heading for 15. How in God's name, Minister, can you stand up here and tell us that this is going to bring down the cost of electricity? We see that your government previously has shoved the cost to industry over onto consumers. They did it secretly, it was found out. The other point is, and this is the question, we have one more, that'll do. We have 2,200 megawatts of wind energy. That's 40% of our average demand. What scientific way have you to measure the impact of wind? Unless you have a scientific way to measure the impact of wind in the system, you cannot stand up and say what your targets are. You have to have a way of calculating it. Now, I have a good lot of things here and I can't go on. All I want to say is this is not public consultation whatsoever. There needs to be an arrangement made where somebody like me can meet department officials with the minister's knowledge and get these questions answered, because I can tell you, we're heading to the courts. Don't be in any doubt about it. Not alone that, we're looking at the possibility of using the Maastricht Treaty to gain up to £100,000 or euros per person who is put about by the failure to abide by the regulations on these projects. You are breaking the law. Thank you.
Okay. All right, over here on the left.
Good morning, Minister. Charles Stanley Smith from Antashka and the Environmental Pillar. First off, I'd like to thank you for showing us your understanding of the critical nature of climate change and the urgent need to do something about it, and thank you for that. But I would like you, if possible, can you contact your fellow minister, Alan Kelly, to ask him to strengthen his climate action bill, which really does need to be strengthened to ensure that we meet our 2020 targets and beyond. But somebody in the hall mentioned the fact there's the little knowledge in the rural areas. I come from Tipperary, in a rural area there. I really feel it's important to have on-the-ground agencies. I'd like to support, for instance, the Tipperary Energy Agency as an independent source of knowledge for people. I think that needs to be strengthened and put around in many more counties. And also as a source for people in the country to understand climate change and understand the needs for the sort of things that we have to do to tackle climate change. And I say, I think we need to have a network of agencies supported like the Tipperary Energy Authority. But the final thing then is on decarbonisation. Could you tell us about your plans to take peat totally out of the equation? Digging up an acre of peat is about 20 times worse than cutting down an acre of rainforest. And we give out to the Brazilians for doing so, but we're happily digging up peat in this country. We have to stop, and stop soon. And again, the idea of Money Point has to be closed. It is not possible to run Moneypoint on imported American biofuel. It just won't work. And finally, I'd like to thank you for name-checking Antashka's really successful green school program. Thank you for that.
Okay, over here. Behind you with the beard.
Thank you, Minister, and thank you for the department for organising this stakeholder information session. My name is Rick Pasquale from the Geothermal Association of Ireland, and I have a question for the Minister, and I wondered if he could perhaps allude to any policy that is included in, or strategy that is included in the policy paper with regard to renewable heat and addressing the heat market in Ireland, and in particular, if geothermal energy is covered as one of the technologies which are potentially being considered aside from biofuels and biomass. Thank you.
Okay, that's our group of three for now. Ken?
Okay, thank you, Chair. I might just, again, take them in reverse order, and I might just ask Brian to address the question around the renewable heat initiative and the role for
Brian,
Jude.
Perhaps if you're responding, if you could turn and face the audience, because okay. Some people won't.
Yeah, okay.
On renewable heat, we're shortly to go out to public consultation on the introduction of renewable heat incentive. And again, that'll be the opportunity for people who have interest in different technologies to make their views known, to provide information on potential costs and so on. So I'd imagine in the coming weeks that consultation will be up on the website, so that'll be the opportunity.
Thanks for that, Brian. Just on the environmental pillar contribution and various different statements made around strengthening the Climate Action Bill, and obviously that is a matter for Minister Kelly. But again, it's something we can discuss as part of the interdepartmental group, but I think it's fairly set in stone at this stage. I do agree with the importance of the independent agencies on the ground, and I have to say the Tipperary organisation is showing great leadership and are to be commended for what they're doing there. In terms of decarbonisation and taking peat out of the equation, I think we have to remember that the peat stations have been state aid cleared because of the importance of the security of supply that they were providing at the time that they were cleared, and they have a clearance up until I think it's around the end of this decade. But Bord na Mona management, I know, are very focused on what next after state aid's clearance finishes up. And there is a strong focus on getting into renewables and getting into co-firing. So we just have to watch that space and see what happens. Coming back to Val Martin's contribution, I guess, Val, we're quite clear on the perspectives that you have. And as you said, you do intend to be proactive in that space. All we can say is our agencies, in terms of the state agencies, they do have frameworks within which they do have to operate. Obviously, as a state agency, they will always abide by the rule of law as they see it. And as far as government is concerned, they continue to abide by the rule of law and will do so in the future.
Over here on the right.
Thank you. Grattan Healy, Eireann Limited, also representing the Irish Wind Farmers Association. 2 points, if I could, Minister, especially in response to your demand for, let's say, high-level input. And by the way, compliments on your presentation. But in that presentation, you touched on low carbon. This seems to be the overall theme of the paper. But at various other points, you said carbon-free. So I'm interested to know, a low carbon target or aim is a bit vague, whereas a carbon free target is pretty clear. And I'm just wondering, should we not really be saying to ourselves, look, 2050, no more carbon, on balance anyway. So that would be one broad question. And the other one, which I haven't heard a lot about, is that the world is moving, the energy sector is moving towards a decentralized model throughout the world. You see that in places like Hawaii and all over the place, in fact, where you see a lot more involvement of ordinary citizens as prosumers, producing their own, driving their own electric vehicles and so on. I don't hear that theme jumping out from what we've heard so far. And if the world is going that way, are we not better to jump on that train and try and be up there with the best? rather than saying, no, we're going to have a purely centralized model and then eventually wake up in 10 years' time and realize that we should have gone the decentralized route and encourage people to produce their own energy, to power their own electric vehicles and the rest of it. So decentralized would be the main point. Thank you very much indeed.
Here, in the middle. No, sorry. No, sorry. It was that gentleman first.
Yeah, no problem. Get your hand over early.
Minister, just to rise to your challenge in terms of taking it to a high level, the discourse...
Sorry, could you give your name and...
Sorry, yes, Brendan McGrath of Gay Electric. The discourse so far has been a little bit like, Lord make me pure, but not quite yet. It's very evident from your own interpretation that we're facing a very serious climate event in the next couple of years. And yet there's no mention in your discourse about a carbon tax. So on the basis that the polluter pays, why aren't we advocating a strong carbon tax?
Okay, very clear. Okay, over here on the left. The gentleman with the cream jacket.
David Hughes from the Passive House Association of Ireland. Minister, you opened a conference a couple of weeks ago, the Green Room Conference, and you spoke there about energy efficiency. And I noted your comments on energy efficiency today, but I feared that the method of funding them will continue to be a sort of low-scale grant-type application. I feel one of the reasons energy efficiency in buildings hasn't taken off is precisely because the mechanism for funding it is very poor. I mean, I think 137 million has been the total expenditure to date on energy efficiency, whereas the payments to wind farms in 1 year are about 500 million. And if we retrofit the buildings, we can probably reduce our electricity consumption by about 50%. So that opens up a whole new model of, in terms of how we actually develop our infrastructure. I was at the Air Grid presentation in Cork, and Michael Walsh here was there as well, and I invited them to look at a model where the energy consumption, electricity consumption is reduced by 50% by 2030. And what implication would that have in terms of the expenditure that is planned for that? If you also look at presentations by Yanis Bialak in Durham University and also our own Mark O'Malley, they show that there's a technical limit to the amount of wind that you can have on a system. So it stands to reason that if we're on the trajectory of reducing the demand to keep in line with EU targets on energy reduction, that we cannot continually grow the amount of renewables. There's a technical limit to that. So therefore, it becomes surplus to requirements. So what I would invite you to do, Minister, is as part of the overall energy paper, is to look at a model for the deep retrofit of old building stock in Ireland and see what that would produce in terms of the implications for all the other energy policies. I honestly feel that the method for funding deep retrofit, as Lisa Ryan was saying, we need to really move to an investment model, look at an energy-saving feed-in tariff. I call it a megawatt feed-in tariff or a new fit. And as I said to you before, Minister, the amount of money we can save is about $2 billion per year, and it's the equivalent of finding a carb gas field every 6 years forever.
Okay. All right. That's our three for now. Okay.
Thank you, Chair. Minister, if I may, I'll just maybe jump in on the carbon and kind of Grattan's and Brendan's questions are kind of interrelated. One of the things that we will be looking to the EU on is a fair price for carbon. And I personally think, and Minister, you'll have your own comments in relation to the tax, I personally think that it is important that there is a fair price for carbon and that the price of carbon is increased significantly in order to drive investment into low or no carbon technologies. And that is, as I said, one of the things that we'll be looking to the EU to do as part of the Energy Union package. Also important in that regard is the importance of interconnection and more interconnection with other European Union member states. So both of those, I think, are important in terms of ensuring that we get to low or no carbon. I think it's also important to mention on Grattan's piece that technology will play a part in terms of allowing us to have some low dependence on fossil fuels, but to net out the carbon emissions. So carbon capture and storage, not yet commercially viable, but something is going to have to happen in order to allow us to have some low dependence on fossil fuels, but in a carbon neutral way. And our, I suppose, signalling of our intention to be a big player when it comes to the European Energy Innovation Hub is with a view to facilitating the development of those technologies. I couldn't agree more on the energy efficiency. I mean, it is hugely, hugely important for us to get that as right as we possibly can. I guess government is constrained in terms of the amount of money it will have to spend, but it is important for us to grant aid, as well as to figure out how to incentivise from an investment perspective.
Yeah, I might just add briefly three issues that have arisen in the last few minutes that I think are the points very persuasive. The issue, Grattan Healy's points in relation to the energy citizen. I'm sorry if it wasn't sufficient emphasis in the speech, but certainly I value very, very highly the whole principle and reality of the energy citizen, and that we should deploy all of the emerging technologies to put the citizen at the centre of this transition. You mentioned electric vehicles. Other people have mentioned microgeneration. The ownership model point that was mentioned by the colleague earlier on. I think each of these has to be addressed in the white paper. And I think that absolutely has to be, something that I'm very persuaded by. I'm also persuaded, I have to say, by Brendan's point in relation to carbon tax. And here I'll be engaged in a little bit of free thinking. I mean, anything that you read, any of the literature that you read and you try, as somebody like me coming into this, to get an understanding of what can work for the future, it's very, very hard to avoid the proposition that you make in relation to carbon tax. There isn't a consensus on that. As you know, there isn't a consensus. We have to work with our partners in the EU in relation to something, a policy instrument like that. But if you're asking me what I think myself, I think that it's just hard to avoid in any of the analysis I've read that ultimately you've got a price, you've got to put a price on carbon, and the way we do that in terms of policy instruments is, I think, one of the ways in any event, is through taxation. So if you want my view, that's it. And how exactly we can reflect that in the white paper, we're considering. And then the third point, which I just reiterate what Ken said, is in relation to the apps. I mean, again, the completely persuasive and compelling points about energy efficiency. Lisa Ryan made the point earlier on as well. What can be delivered there and what can be achieved is immense. And you rightly point to the question of funding and the funding mechanisms. And, we've done... how can I put this? I think we've done as well as we could be expected to have done in terms of funding, given the economic collapse that occurred and the restrictions on funding for practically everything in our economy. Things have changed in that regard, and things are changing, and my colleagues in government know the importance that I attach to funding. And as you say, to innovative mechanisms of funding, not just the actual money, but innovative mechanisms to fund energy efficiency, and you mentioned deep retrofit. So I'm hearing all of these points and noting all of them. Can I just because I'm not personally answering all the questions, everything you say, and that's why I say, whatever length of time we have, if there's anything, if there's anything we're missing, I would actually prefer, Chair, and I'm in your hands, but... we've a limited amount of time. If we had 6, 8, 10 bullets of 1 minute each of things that people want me to hear and want us to hear, I would value that. But I'm in your hands as to how you want to proceed.
Okay. Minister, we'll take your wishes on board. We've got...
I'm used to bullets in my job.
Okay. We're now at 26 minutes past 12, so we'll take the Minister's suggestion on board as our last foray. We'll take two from each section because there are people from everywhere, and you've got a minute in order to make your comment or your issue. Okay, so over here on the left. A minute.
My name is John Dooley. I'm from EPAW, and I'm an engineer, and I've done an analysis of about 7,000 Danish wind turbines over the last number of years, and I've recently done an analysis of 2,600 decommissioned Danish wind turbines, okay? I've done a trend line on them, and the trend line is negative. Post 1995, there has been a dramatic drop in the operating life of Danish wind turbines, accompanied with a dramatic drop in their capacity factor over their lives, okay? So you've got to figure this in the capacity of wind power you're going to have to put in to achieve your targets. Wind turbines typically lose 50% of their capacity factor over 6 years, and another 50% over another 6 years. So that by year 10, they're producing at 25% of what in year one, okay? So you would want to figure out what capacity you're going to need to achieve this, because I don't think technically it's possible. To get the 37% target, you need about well over 20,000 megawatts. The output over the last few years has flatlined. There has been no increased penetration of the market. And the SEAI has recently got around that by saying the percentage of production, which is not the target. The target is penetration of the market. And you were told in 2004 by the ESB that if you add more and more production capacity of wind, the output tends toward zero. And that's what's happening. In my opinion, you cannot get above 20%, no matter how many thousands of megawatts you put up in the country.
Okay.
So you need to totally reevaluate your policy, because in my opinion, it ain't going to work.
Okay. Yeah. Number one. Number two, here.
Hi, Joanne Addy from Road in County Offaly. Minister, I would like to say thank you very much for inviting me and the presentation on the policy. I look forward to actually reading it all as merely a citizen. And that's my point. I would like you just to bear in mind that any policy you bring out will hugely impact on ordinary residents across all of Ireland. I, for one, yes, industrial wind turbine proposed out my back garden. I'm the NIMBY, except I think it's wrong in anybody's back garden. And I would encourage you to liaise with Minister Kelly to try and come up and encourage a fair setback and more stringent guidelines in relation to this, because developers are out there and just popping up all over the place, and we need to have stronger regulation in place. Thank you.
Okay. At the back there. Okay.
Hello, can you hear me? My name is Leslie O'Hora from Good Energies Alliance, Carrigan Shannon, with 4 votes in Dublin South.
I'm all ears.
But seriously, I was very impressed by your presentation, Minister. And I came here to do a battle, but discovered that you'd stolen all our clothes, you know. So if Ned Broy was here, he'd have something to say about it. Anyway, what I was going to say is, very briefly, we're in Good Energies Alliance very, very interested in the concept of energy co-ops. We are holding a meeting on the 25th of June in Manor Hamilton. We're inviting speakers from Scotland who set up energy co-ops or trusts to actually address the people of Manor Hamilton. In Scotland at the moment, there are 400 energy co-ops who are actually putting 250 million sterling back into the local economies. If you compare that with 6 million euros of leader funding, that really makes us look Mickey Mouse. So I would really encourage you to go the co-op route, particularly for small rural communities, because it all adds up.
Okay.
Okay. Right. Just one other point.
No, please. Just in the interest of everybody.
Okay. Just very briefly. Well, okay. On thermal solar. Okay. 1 in 4 homes in Austria has solar. In Ireland, we're looking at 0.4% per thousand. Could the minister please pick up the phone and phone his counterpart in Austria and ask him, how do they do it? Thank you.
Okay, all right, that was brief. Could I ask at this point Sean Lyons and come in?
Thank you. I wanted to, first of all, sort of thank the minister for a couple of the points
made.
Sorry,
Sean, if you would just brief the audience.
Sean Lyons, ESRI. Yeah, I was encouraged by a couple of the indications you gave about the likelihood of continuing to research the best ways to deliver energy efficiency and also the upcoming strategy for energy affordability. Also, I thought it was interesting the indication that the department is sensitive to this issue about the kind of mismatch in understanding between the consumer and the energy suppliers with regard to the retail market. One of the things that I think unifies these is that there's generally a difficulty for consumers in these markets. They've become more complicated. They don't understand the energy transition to the extent that suppliers do. And so I think it's important in framing the strategy to take into account some of these issues around consumer behavior and in our developing understanding of how consumers adopt energy efficient technologies and some of the barriers to that, which are maybe not what we thought they were. It isn't simply about spending a lot of money on it. It isn't even necessarily going to work spending a lot of money on it, because sometimes you'll give grants to people or offer grants to people and they won't take them up. Equally on energy affordability, we have a group of people there who maybe don't understand or don't participate in the same way in markets, and we need to look at how to look after vulnerable people. So I was encouraged to hear you highlight that. And then finally, on this issue of the workings of the retail market, this is absolutely central to the whole project. We're operating in a competitive market at this point, all the way down to the residential consumer. If retail competition doesn't work very well, that tends to cause an unraveling of the whole process, because it undermines the trust of the consumer. And as you, I think, also highlighted, trust is central to the operation of these markets, where you've got lots of innovation coming in over time. People have to be prepared to accept that innovation.
Okay. We've had four comments so far. Just here, in the blue shirt.
Thank you very much. Robert Goss from Solar Electric Ireland. I've got a question on behalf of the concerned energy citizens. We've met hundreds of them who would like to install solar PV on their houses right now. And the only reason why they're not is because they're waiting for the policy. So can we have a policy, and can we also have a policy which states, and your department states, that whatever you introduce will be retrospective? So if you introduce something in 9 months' time, it'll be retrospective to somebody who fits solar PV on their house today.
Okay. Over here, down at the back. Down here, no, further back. The gentleman with the glasses. Yeah.
Jerry Duggan, Irish Academy of Engineering. Given that oil currently supplies over half of our energy needs and contributes over half of our national CO2 emissions, I heard remarkably little discussion to date on how that is going to be reduced in the period we're talking about.
Okay, over here on the left.
Neil Walker, IBEC. One of the things that's really come on the radar in the last 6 months, so since the first round of consultations, is the energy unions is now, the European Commission is starting to think about telling member states how to run their electricity markets. Previously, they've only talked about how to have efficient trade. Given that we're going to spend a couple of €100 million getting the systems in place to be able to cope with the target model for cross-border trading, we want to make sure that we get 10 years use out of it and not have to make further very costly changes in maybe 3 or 4 years' time because of this new thing coming up on the horizon. So how do we future-proof our electricity market design, I think, is worth thinking about.
Okay. Two more comments. Okay. Here, beside you. Yeah.
Thank you, Chair. Harold Kingston from Irish Farmers Association. Minister, you mentioned quite a number of times in your presentation about climate change, and I, as a farmer, I would always be saying that food security has to be part of that, and as you said in your presentation, energy security also has to be part of our tackling climate change. And in the multifunctional role that agriculture has, we want to be part of this solution. We're often blamed for an awful lot of things, but we want to be part of this, and in particular in terms of producing renewables. And I'm delighted to hear about the RHI being talked about reasonably shortly in terms of producing heat. We as farmers, we can produce the raw materials, but in order to do that, we need to see a secure market. And if I plant a field of barley, I can decide to plant something else next year. If I decide to plant a crop for biomass, it's a generational decision. It is a long-term decision. There has to be a proper, financially attractive, long-term incentive in place. The second and final point is to do with hosting infrastructure. You mentioned a number of times about community engagement and people, the decisions that affect them. As landowners, obviously, infrastructure is directly, we're direct hosts to infrastructure. And you mentioned about North-South coming up reasonably shortly in terms of a planning application being made. Can I again make sure that all options are put on the table in that planning application? That does not simply restrict it to saying that it has to be looking at underground, it has to be looking at energy efficiency, it has to be looking at other options, the same as GridLink is now looking at other options, the same as GridWest is now looking at other options. Make sure that the decision is based on having all options on the table for Bord Pleanála. Thank you, okay. Minister.
The lady behind the navy dress.
Hi, I'm Teresa O'Donoghue with the People's Energy Charter and the Environmental Pillar. I very much welcome your address, Minister. It was very positive and everything I wanted to hear. I second the polluter pay principle. But I'm worried about the practicalities and the balance or the imbalance of power amongst what our citizens can actually achieve and what industry has the capacity to do. When you look at, there's a lot of current consultations across Europe and some in Ireland. Companies have the funds to put someone in place to write loads of submissions to these things. As a citizen, what capacity am I going to have to write submissions to this? I'm even involved with the NGOs for the past year, going to conferences, seeing how businesses can afford these €900 tickets to go to a conference. Citizens can't afford that sort of information or insight. We don't have, even within the NGOs, the funding and the capacity to make enough submissions. I can't see how citizens, how are you going to want to see the practicalities on how you're going to deliver engaging citizens and capacity building so that we actually can do it ourselves?
Okay. All right. We've had a wide range in number of issues outlined there. And perhaps if we can group them.
Sure. Thank you, Chair. I guess a lot of the contributions were statements and responses to the Minister's call, but there were some things that I might just pick up on. Just starting with Teresa's contribution, I think Teresa again was a fairly regular visitor at our seminars, and we actually engaged offline as well to ensure that we understood exactly what your perspective was, and we learned a lot from that. Do accept that it is difficult for the citizen to compete with the big industry when it comes to having your voice heard, which for me underlines the importance of us having had these sessions and having engaged offline with a huge amount of people on foot of the various initiatives that we did have. We were very keen today to ensure that it was open to everybody and free in. And if you don't mind me saying it, and I hope it doesn't sound pompous, I guess we as civil servants do feel that we have a privilege in terms of the positions that we hold, but with that privilege goes a responsibility to be the guardians of the public interest to the very best of our ability. And I would hope that we would reflect the citizen's voice in the options that we would put forward to the Minister from the guardian of the public interest perspective. But that is really, really important to me and to all of my colleagues, and I know it's very important to the Minister, and we would act in accordance with your instructions on that. Just on Harold's contribution around the importance of food security, again, this emphasises the importance of an interdepartmental approach to the implementation of energy policy. Food security is one of the big issues that is in the mix when it comes to our discussions with our European partners when it comes to Framework 2030 and what it is that will be expected of Ireland. We do have a growing national herd, and it is hugely important, not just to Ireland's food security, but also to Europe's food security, and that's well recognised throughout the EU. Neil made the point around the energy union and this evolution in terms of the EU giving us guidance on efficient trade and seeming to be becoming more involved in terms of telling us how to run our energy system. It's something Una and I are very, very conscious of. It's something that the Minister is very conscious of at Energy Council. And we have been quite vocal in terms of highlighting that we are developing SEM into the ISEM. That's taking quite a lot of time and effort and investment. And it's not acceptable for that rug to be pulled from under us in terms of any future requirements from the European Union. And I'm fairly confident that we won't find ourselves in a situation where all of that good work and investment is undone. Gerry Gavin made the point around oil and how to reduce in the period out to 2030. I think that's where the importance of a fair price for carbon comes into it. And Minister's already addressed the issue of carbon tax. It is the case that we are very dependent on oil for the vast majority of our transport and a huge amount of our homes. More than 50% are dependent on oil for heating. That is something that we are going to have to tackle. And I certainly believe that a fair price for carbon is important in terms of trying to achieve that. There was mentioned by a few contributors of the importance of solar. Yes, it's on our mind, but again, part of the studies that we will be doing around REFIT 4 and other studies will ensure that we maximise value for money and whether or not solar can be as competitive as other technologies remains to be seen, but it is important that we would rule out no technology and consider the part that every technology can potentially play. Sean Lyons mentioned consumer behaviour and barriers to adopting energy efficiency. Yes, that's something that we absolutely need to try and figure out. We know that, for example, the Cabinet Office in the UK have the Nudge Unit. That's now starting to spread out in terms of influencing other departments as to how they can actually get consumers to do things which seem like it's common sense, but there seems to be some barriers to actually taking up those common sense initiatives and making common sense coming up application. Just very quickly, great to hear about the Manor Hamilton energy co-ops, and yes, it is the case that we're very impressed with what's going on in Scotland, and it is again something that will be part of the consultation that we do in terms of the renewable energy approaches of the future. So watch that space in terms of energy co-ops. And again, can I just mention, learned a huge amount from my visit to the Aran Islands Energy Co-op, and again, great to see the local leadership going on there, as well as in Derry, in Temple Derry. And there is, we think, something there which we need to nourish in order that it would flourish. Joanne mentioned the need to be respectful of all citizens, most especially those who will be impacted by infrastructure rollout. And we hear that message loudly and clearly, and it's something that has come across very loudly and clearly, not just today, but in all of the regional and rural seminars that we did. And then finally, John's point about the decommissioning of wind turbines. Again, that's something that we would be happy to take more detail on that. But it is something that we are alert to. But having said that, we're conscious of the fact that there will be a role for onshore wind, given the constant improvements in the technologies. Minister.
Okay. It's now 12:45. The level of energy in the room is intense, there's no doubt about that. But I think it's appropriate at this stage to ask the Minister if you'd like to sum up on behalf of the proceedings this morning.
Yeah, I'll just do a very short conclusion, if I may. I think that there's probably no need for me to recap too much on what's been said, other than to reassure you again that everything that's been said has been heard and been noted. I know by my officials who are here in the front, you heard from Brian Carroll, but there are other of his colleagues in the front row here listening and taking a careful note of what's been said. I suppose some of the points that have emerged have included highlighting the greater involvement of the citizen in the formulation and implementation of policy. And, you know, I take Theresa's point about how precisely that can be made into a reality, that it goes beyond simply a statement by a minister, that it's of its importance, but that it kind of can be embedded in the way we actually do our work. And I think the most practical way of that happening actually touches back on some of the points that were being made by Grattan and others about how the citizen becomes an agent as opposed to, as it were, a victim of change. And I think that's the way I would see us. And we will have to deal with that, and we will deal with that in the white paper in a tangible way. And the co-ownership points very well taken. The importance people are placing on clarifying the technologies that will feature in the future, our REFIT 4 process, the need for that to come through sooner rather than later. I have that point from people in the audience. Also, similarly, to the need to finalise our bioenergy strategy so that it can feed in the way we want it to do in our energy policy, which will be framed by the white paper. Other points that I've noted with interest, the possibility of improving the EIS and EIA processes, which we can certainly reflect on with the colleagues in the Department of the Environment, potential for solar PV, raised a number of times, the importance of the OREDP. Just lots of points, some of which I suppose not everybody in the room has agreed on everything. If they were, this process would be very easy. But I do have to say that I take Ken's point about the role that he has and his colleagues in the department have, and I, by extension, have, in terms of being the custodian of the public interest. A lot of discussion about the public interest in another context in the last few days. But it is of critical importance that we listen, we analyse, we understand, but that we make decisions. And that's what the people expect us to do. And that is really essentially what the white paper is largely about, pulling together the strands of the debate and the analysis and facilitating a move forward by the entire community and country in relation to what we're doing. Can I just say, Harold, in relation to the IFA and the importance and the contribution that farmers and farming and innovative farming that you've demonstrated, I think the IFA, I've met you actually about broadband, but also in relation to this agenda, very much appreciate and value your role. Point was made, not sure if Ken, I think you did address it briefly. I take the point about the energy union and the need to, as it were, future-proof what's done in terms of new market design and market construction. It's a point I make, actually, I'll be in Luxembourg next Monday, we'll make the point again if I get the chance, that we can't have a process of uncertainty reaching into the future where changes are made, let's see how they go, and 4 or 5 years later, we're not clear on what those changes meant, and people look to adjust the situation again. Certainty is, insofar as it can be achieved, certainty is of huge importance, I think, to all of us, particularly in relation to markets and how they're designed. Lastly, I just want to thank everybody who's been here this morning. It's been hugely valuable to me. I want to thank the officials that I've done. Ken, I want to thank Bernie for graciously chairing in a very measured way the debate. I want to thank every single person who's attended. I don't normally single people out, but he'll be surprised to hear me singling him out. I'm delighted to see my colleague Deputy Kulreevy here as a representative of the Oireachtas, as a member of the relevant Oireachtas committee, because we'll also take this outline of where we're at to the Oireachtas committee in the coming weeks, and I do appreciate his interest and those of his colleagues on that committee. Not everybody can be everywhere at the same time as politicians. Busy people here in the room will appreciate that. But perhaps he and I can collaborate with the man just directly in front of him who's inviting us all to a conference in Manor Hamilton some point in June. So thank you all once again for your attendance. Thank you for your insights, and I look forward to seeing you all again soon.
And just to say that the Minister's speech and the press release will be available on the Department's website shortly. Okay. Thank you.